Hello and welcome to a new video in the series Verge3D for Blender Basics. In this tutorial, we'll be adapting the user interface that we created previously for mobile devices. To see how the UI would look on different devices, open the browser console. In Chrome, you can press F12 on your keyboard. Then click the small icon in the top left corner and it will enable the mobile mode. This is of course just a simulation, but it spares you having to test your app on real tablets or smartphones. As you can see, it looks pretty well in the horizontal layout. Except maybe the buttons are too big, but at least they are positioned properly. However, in the vertical layout, the buttons are way too big. Worse, they obstruct the viewport, preventing the user from interacting with the 3D content. There are other issues we are going to fix as well. Let's begin making the user interface mobile friendly. We'll be doing it in Webflow, a tool that we used for creating UI in the first place. This tool has powerful means for mobile optimization. On the top bar there are a few buttons. These buttons switch the page from desktop to tablet and then to horizontal or vertical smartphone view layout. So we can check our UI and see how it will look in these modes. The tool even hints real tablets and smartphones that correspond to the current screen resolution. So, let's adapt the UI for mobile devices. In fact, it looks well in the tablet mode, so we won't be changing anything here. In the horizontal smartphone layout, the only thing we may change is make the buttons smaller a bit, so that the 3D content has more space. Make sure we are in the horizontal smartphone layout and change the size for the buttons. For example, make it 60 by 60 pixels. If you check how it looks in desktop mode now, we can see that nothing changed. So the changes we make will only affect smartphones, and only when they are in the horizontal layout. Then we make all other buttons smaller as well. The buttons now look separated, so we should fix the distances between them. We should also adjust both the left and the right panels, so that they fit the size of the buttons. The size should be something like 220, or actually even less, 200 pixels. We also need to change the offset relative to the bottom edge, so that the panel keeps being centered. Make it 100 pixels, which is half of the panel size. Excellent, the buttons keep being centered. Finally, we should adjust the UI to look great in the vertical smartphone layout. Although the buttons are now smaller, this seems to be not enough. The buttons should be rearranged as well. The left panel will go to the top and the buttons become arranged in a row, while the right panel will go to the bottom horizontally. To do this, we should edit the styles of our panels and the styles of the divs that position them. First of all, we need to modify the positioning div. It is snapped to the top left corner, this is OK. Now we remove the right offset, making it 0 pixels. The height will be constant, 60 pixels, which is the same as the height of a button. And we set the width to 50%. Now the right edge of the positioning div is situated strictly in the middle. Now we need to snap the left panel's internal div to the right edge, so that the left edge of this div is now situated in the middle. And we can now resize the left panel. Make it height 60 pixels, the same as the height of a button. And set the width to 200 pixels to embody all three buttons. Remove the offset by setting it to 0. Instead, we'll be offsetting the panel relative to the right edge by minus 100 pixels. Now the panel is centered, the only thing left is to fix the buttons. The first button is OK already. The second button should have 0 for its top spacing. And we shift it to the right by 70 pixels. The third button should also have 0 for top spacing and shift it by 140 pixels. Now the left panel buttons will be in their new place on the top when viewed on a smartphone. Let's repeat the same procedure with the right panel buttons. Set snapping to bottom left corner. This caused the buttons to go down, but we'll fix it shortly. The first button is already fine. The second button should have 0 here and 70 here. Same for the third button. The right panel should also have its width set to 200 pixels and height to 60 pixels for now. Then set spacing, bottom set to 0 and left also set to 0. The right spacing should be minus 100 pixels. Now let's lift the bottom panel a bit, say by 10 pixels. And the same should be done for the top panel, also shifted by 10 pixels. The only thing left is to make a 0 height for both panels, so that they don't obstruct the mouse cursor. For the bottom panel, we should set the spacing to 70 pixels rather than 10. Now we finish it with the horizontal smartphone layout. Let's see how it works in our app. Save and click Export Code. Download the archive and unzip it to the app folder, replacing the older files. Let's just reload the page and see how the UI changed. It looks great. We can check it on various devices and layouts. Also on a tablet. looks fine everywhere. However, there is an issue when viewing on the vertical layout. The model seems to be too small. This is because the viewport is resized to fit the width of the canvas. If we change the viewport to make it depend on the height instead, the model should become bigger. To do this, let's return to Blender. Select the camera and switch its sensor fit setting to vertical, so that the camera will fit the canvas by its top and bottom edges. Now export and refresh the app. Awesome! The camera is much closer to the model now. Maybe a bit too close, but we can zoom it out if necessary. If we now turn off the mobile mode and go back to desktop, we see that it also looks great at this resolution. So this is it with adapting the UI for mobile devices. We still have a few issues. The first problem is that it is not clear that these buttons are actually clickable. There is no visual hint that they are interactive. The second problem is that the buttons are visible right away before the app is loaded, which looks weird. The third issue that there is no favicon. The flow added some default favicon, but we want it to be our own logo. And finally, there is a typo in the project name which we want to fix. So let's fix all these problems in Webflow. Select a button and return to editing the main style shared between all buttons. To do this, click this link in the Selectors panel. Select the button style and scroll all the way down. And select pointer for the mouse cursor. Now return back so that all styles become visible again. And check how it looks in the preview mode. As we can see, the cursor changes its form when hovered over any of the buttons. Exit the preview mode. The next issue is the initial visibility of the buttons. We should have both the left and right panels hidden initially, and only reveal them after the app is fully loaded. To do this, select the right panel div, go to the Properties tab and assign an ID to it. Name it Right Panel with underscore. Now get back to the styling tab and hide it. Proceed with the left panel in the same manner. Assign an ID and hide. This is it. Now let's fix the last two issues, the favicon and the project name. This can be done in the project settings. Fix the project name and here we can assign our own favicons, which you can find in the starter files. Done, return back to the editor and export the code. Replace all the files and refresh the app. Buttons are no longer visible, neither before nor after loading, we'll have to add some logic to reveal them. And we get our own favicon, which is great. So, to reveal the buttons after the app is loaded, we should leverage the puzzles editor. There will be no UI visible in this small viewport window. This is because the puzzles editor works only with 3D app itself and ignores all other HTML files. But we can work with the scenario here and check the results in another browser tab. So we need to reveal the buttons. This can be realized with an HTML puzzle called setStyle4Element. We'll be changing the CSS property called display. Now I added a text puzzle and inserted here. We'll be changing the value to block. Copy and paste it and insert to the element slot. Then specify the ID of the div, which we want to reveal, left panel. This element is part of another HTML file, to which our 3D app is embedded. So we should also check in parent doc, otherwise it won't find the element. Copy and paste this block and modify it for right panel. Now save and refresh the app, which is running in the other tab. The buttons are revealed, but only after the app is loaded, thanks to these two blocks. You can also see that the cursor changed to pointer, then hovered over the buttons. Also, the page title is now correct. In fact, we can further optimize these blocks. Instead of using two blocks, we can use a list puzzle. We can add these two IDs to the list and remove the unused third item. This list can be now used with the setStyle puzzle. So this puzzle will set the CSS property display to value block for both elements in the list. Save, refresh and see that it works basically as before. Yet our scenario is now a bit more compact. That's it! Thanks for watching and see you in the next video!